Good evening, everyone, and thank you for being with us here today. Moving on to the third panel of the evening, we have with us Molly Crabapple and Raghu Karnad, who will be conversing about how art and writing impacts activism, politics, and current realities. Without much ado, I shall further introduce our panelists. Molly Crabapple is a New York-based artist and writer. Her memoir, Drawing Blood, was released in December 2015. She is a contributing editor for Vice and has written for publications including the New York Times, Paris Review, and Vanity Fair. Her work is also in the permanent collection of the Museum of Modern Art. Raghu Karnad, who will be in conversation with Molly, is a journalist and the author of Father's Field, an Indian story of the Second World War. He has written for several publications, such as the International New York Times, the Financial Times, N Plus One, and the Caravan, and is also a contributing editor at The Wire, an independent online publication of opinion and reportage. Thank you.
Okay, nobody panic. Nobody panic, but I've just received news that World War III has begun. Okay? What you hear over there, that's probably the evacuation of South Bombay. Everyone is going to Bandra for the last time. It's not clear who's involved, what the sides are. It's not clear the nature of the conflict, and it's certainly not clear how it's going to end. But the good news is, we probably have an hour before anything starts to fall from the sky. The other good news is that we have with us this evening Molly Crabapple, who is the ideal person to tell us a little bit about the arts of survival and the survival of art in the 21st century and in this new warlike world. So, Molly, you've had an extraordinary career as an artist, and you've produced a variety of different kinds of work. I want to walk through a couple of different hypotheses with you about what this Third World War is. Okay, the first, the most obvious candidate has to do with this snarl of terrible armed conflicts and collapsing states in Central Asia. In the Middle East. But I want to bring Molly in on that a little bit later. Let's start with a less apparent conflict, but a more important, but an equally important one. And this has to do with what I see as being a sort of ecological battle, a sort of global reckoning that we're just starting to recognize between forces of human greed and the constraints both of human societies and of the environment. Now, this is a good question. This is a question I've been wanting to put to you, Molly, because in your life, one of the turning points for your work and for your identity, I think your identity as an artist, was Occupy Wall Street, right? Do you want to tell us about how you found yourself as a part of that?
How many people here know about Occupy Wall Street? Our troublemaking spread across the world. Occupy Wall Street was a series of protest encampments that started in New York City that spread across the country and then across the world. They started with protesting against capitalism, but later expanded to address a huge variety of related issues, from murders by police to deportation of immigrants in America. Occupy Wall Street also happened outside my window. Before Occupy, I was an artist who was primarily known for drawing really, really sexy girls who were dancing at nightclubs. And while drawing sexy girls who are dancing at nightclubs is a totally intellectually valid thing, and those girls are sharp and tough warriors as far as I'm concerned, I was also yearning to do something else with my work. And then when this protest encampment happened, and for the first time in a long time, I felt like the left was both united and was doing something that was dangerous to power. And you could tell it was doing something dangerous to power because the cops kept arresting us and beating us up.
Including you, personally?
I was never beaten. I was arrested. I was arrested at the one-year anniversary of Occupy Wall Street, probably, I think, because the cop wanted to arrest someone short. You know, they have quotas. They want it to be easy for them. And I was so angry at my arrest, and I wasn't angry at my arrest because it was a very hard arrest. I had a very easy one as far as they go. It was only 11 hours. But I was angry because all arrests are traumatic, and America, one of its great sins as a country, is the lightness with which it treats arresting and incarcerating black people. America is a country that's okay with that. And I was so angry that so much of white, comfortable, middle-class America was okay with inflicting this trauma on people and acted like it was nothing. And so my first essay was about my arrest, and it was about arrest in general.
So that was your birth as a journalist. But I also want to dwell on your art and your life and your work just before Occupy exploded outside of your window, because what you've minimized as drawing beautiful naked girls was actually an extraordinary experience of exploring the world of burlesque, a world that touched that touched sex work, that touched all kinds of performance and sort of lived art, a world where people really had to sort of sacrifice and live as artists in quite an extraordinary way that reminded me of other romantic periods. You know, the one it reminded you of was probably the world illustrated by Toulouse-Lautrec. Exactly.
Toulouse-Lautrec was a French painter from the 1890s who was the chronicler of the Moulin Rouge, the hottest nightclub in Paris, the home of the can-can. And what made Toulouse-Lautrec interesting and what made him a hero of mine was that even though he was drawing these lovely can-can girls, he wasn't just drawing ruffles. He wasn't just drawing pretty things. He was drawing them like warriors engaged in class war. He was drawing them as these ferocious athletes who might have been repressed by all of society, who might have been told that they were meant to be nothing but drudges, meant to be nothing but impoverished workhorses, but in that space they would be queens. He drew it like that, and he drew all the conflict, and he drew all the harshness. He drew all of the bad ends that people might come to, but he drew all of the fight and the struggle. Now, because Toulouse-Lautrec inspired me, I found my own Moulin Rouge. In New York, when I was a young person, there was a burlesque scene. Now, burlesque was a mashup of like striptease and underground performance art. It was taking off your clothes, but also being satirical and angry and dark. It was something that drag queens influenced. It was something that a lot of sex workers, you know, did and created. And it was something that I was obsessed with. So I really found my artistic voice in this community of, you know, strippers, of underground performers, and of sex workers, these men and women that were as tough and as hard and as glittering as diamonds. And then when I was 24, I was able to talk my way into becoming the house artist of perhaps the most swank burlesque club, and in fact, the temple of New York's financial boom. It was called The Box. This was a place where the men who destroyed our economy through dodgy stock market deals would then go to blow through thousands or tens of thousands of dollars a night on champagne just to show that they didn't care, just to show that money meant nothing. Meanwhile, on stage, these performers, like the ones that I worshipped, were doing these acts that were both pornographic and highly skilled, but also were laceratingly cruel to the audience. They were flinging back all of the audience's swinishness in their face. It was creating this scene, this milieu, where the classes rubbed up against each other until they bled, where they were like groping at each other with desire, but they also were kicking each other in the face.
So very important and like stunningly interesting chapter, central chapter in Molly's memoir, which is of course the book we're talking about, Drawing Blood. It has to do with exploring the world of the box and the entire burlesque world that surrounded it. So that was also that probably also focused your practice, your artistic practice, on drawing bodies, which in my observation has been something that that's been continuous even to the present day. I mean, of course, you've drawn shattered landscapes from Gaza and from Raqqa in Syria, and you've drawn a variety, I mean, obviously all sorts of subjects, but I find bodies and human figures to be so central to what you do. Is that something that started with that period, or?
I think it's always been my obsession. I think sometimes your style, it comes from your flaws as well as your virtues. And my flaw, sort of as a child, as an artist, was I couldn't do perspective. I couldn't do like these, you know, deep scenes. I could never draw a car. I would try to draw a car and it would look like a horrible little box with wheels and blobs. I couldn't do straight lines. My hand wanted to do curves. But what I could do was I could draw people. And I think the reason that I first started drawing people obsessively, which was about when I was 7 years old, was because I had no friends and I was really unpopular. And the one way that I could relate to people or just make them stop hating me was I could say, here, I'll draw you. And I was reading this book about the gulag, and I always have this paranoia that like after the zombie apocalypse or if I was thrown into the gulag, you know, I'd be first up against the wall because I'm such a useless artist, and what are we, right? We're, you know, flowers or scum, something useless. But anyway, so I was reading about the gulag, and in actuality, artists were quite coveted and they had quite a position, because when you have nothing, you want to have something, and art is something that makes something out of nothing. Art is something where you take colored mud on a flat surface and you create value out of it, you create beauty and you create joy and representation. So artists did that in Soviet gulags, and I tried to do that in the hell that was middle school.
Right. That's So instead of ending up in the gulag, you ended up in downtown, or not quite downtown, but in a jail cell in New York. So let's go back to Occupy, which is this important moment for you as a person, for New York as a city, for the United States as the pinnacle of the global economy, and for the world, because the rest of the world was finally receiving signals that the completely rampant progress of financial capital was possible to check and to challenge in certain ways. Was Occupy, or, I mean, in some ways, a political education for you? You must have already had certain convictions beforehand.
So I had the intense privilege of having a father who was a Marxist professor who gave me Emma Goldman and Huey Newton books when I was a kid. However, after the complete failure of the Iraq War protests that I took part in very, very enthusiastically, there's a part of me that thought, my God, if I put politics into my art, it's just going to be this preachy lie, you know, just be exploiting it. It felt so futile. And so the political expression that I did was much more, I don't want to say personal, but it was a much smaller scale. Like, it was sex workers' rights stuff, or raising money for abortion funds so that poor women could afford to have abortions. It didn't seem possible to create a challenge to a larger system. In Wall Street, where I live so often before Occupy, I would hear these crowds outside and they'd be screaming, and I would think, oh, they've come with the pitchforks to get the bastards.
At last.
And it never was. It was always a sports game. But then with Occupy, it was. And it was this amazing thing, because I think before Occupy proved anything else, it proved to Americans that they could fight. It proved to Americans that they could protest, that we were not of some cloth that was essentially weaker and poorer than, you know, the kids in Tahrir who were fighting against the dictatorship, or against the anarchists in Greece that were fighting against austerity. It was a moment where we stood up and we learned, in addition to all sorts of specific political things, we learned solidarity and we learned how to link up our arms when the cops charged our protest. We learned practical skills and we learned what it feels like to make someone far more powerful than you back down, even if only for a night.
Now, I don't want to turn this into an election conversation, but I wonder where you, the energies that were concentrated during Occupy that were unrecognizable, except, like, as you say, from the anti-Iraq war protests, which were, I think, more frustrated and in a sense, more damaged by the fact that the war just happened, no matter how unreasonable it was.
They didn't care. No one cared.
How much of a transparent lie. I was at the same anti-Iraq war protests that you describe in New York, in Central Park. And
that's always the delusion, right, at protests, that there are so many of us here, so it has to matter, and it's not true.
Right, it's not true. But do you without turning this into an election conversation, do you see those energies regrouping in some formation in the current context as the run-up to the general
election? What Occupy was a leaderless protest, and in some ways what Occupy was a disappointment with Obama, because so many people who were involved in it, and I count myself as one, we were people who thought that, you know, if Obama was elected, we could redeem ourselves from this shameful, humiliating, violent, criminal garb that we had worn for the last 8 years. We thought that, okay, we'll take off this George Bush costume and then our true face will be revealed and we'll have been good all along. And in actuality, that's not true. You know, we're rotten, and you could take any president in, and even a president who I do believe was a, you know, a good man at the start, like Obama, he is still the president of a rotten system with all the compromises that that implies. And so because of that, I don't think it's possible to have an essentially leaderless movement like Occupy channeled around a presidency. And the thing is, a lot of, or not a lot, but a number of figures did rise to power in the post-Occupy discussions that came out about police violence and also about the economy. One was the mayor of my city, Bill de Blasio, and I was very, very enthusiastic, and Bill de Blasio was someone who got arrested himself at union protests. I mean, I thought, you know, this is our guy. And then as soon as he got elected, he appointed a police chief who was the police chief during the most vile days of our city under Giuliani, our, you know, murderous and racist mayor.
Yeah. Well, some things don't change, but much else has in those, in the period, say, between the beginning of the new wave, U.S. imperialism 2.0, and the present. One of the things that has, and that has really transformed the nature of how we see and respond to conflict and to politics, is technology and the extent to which technology is sort of obviously descended on our lives and our societies. This brings me to the second hypothesis about what World War III might be. This is my personal favorite. This is what I think is going to be the real sort of, you know, blood and gut situation. And this is the war between humanity and the iPhones.
When they finally suck our heads entirely into them and eat us?
Yeah, well, at present, the iPhones are very smart, and they realize that they can use us to reproduce, which is why every year there are more iPhones.
They're like, right? Cats in that case.
Like cats. Cats and iPhones. We're going to have to pit them against each other or something. But you know, I'm a little bit of a Luddite. I have a certain reaction to digital technology, even though I use a lot of it. At the same time, as we were talking about earlier, for both of us, our practice, and I mean our sort of earliest training as artists or as writers, happened on account of the internet. And it has never been entirely separable, including in the latest and most sort of maverick work that you've been doing, not at all separable from that medium and from what that medium allows to be transmitted and shared.
Oh God, I mean, I would not have been allowed to have been an artist without the internet. I went to a terrible school that I dropped out of. I didn't have any professional network. The way people became artists before the internet was that they were born into a fancy class of people, or else they were able to scam their way into charming a member of that fancy class of people who would champion them. There's something massively disruptive about it, and I don't mean that in like the terrible way that startup people use the word disruptive, but I mean an actually disruptive to hierarchies about the internet's ability to give people megaphones to allow them to talk back, to allow them to say when they've been misrepresented on a global stage. However, I think that the internet, and I mean specifically social media, it's not a noble good thing, nor is it an evil bad thing that's eating our heads. It's everything in the same way that the printing press is. It's a means of technology that's so fundamental and crucial to our lives that all of the terrible and wonderful things we do will be amplified and changed through it. However, I absolutely know that without the platform that I got, to be quite frank, initially as a naked model on Suicide Girls, I would not have been able to create that network for myself.
All in the book.
All in the book, yeah.
In fantastic detail, in complete honesty, and with insight that is entirely relatable. I think probably if you're a woman from any walk of life, whether or not you've ever been a naked model, and in fact, if you've just ever been someone who is because Molly has been on both sides of that lens, both as in that period as a subject and as the artist, as the person drawing and watching, for anyone who's turned their lens on the world or had the lens turned on them. But yes, so talking about technology, your skill and what you make is in a sense almost the most pre-modern technology we have. You're doing something.
Right. I mean, this is how they made. This is what they did in caves. This is how they recorded wars. I mean, back before you photographer bastards, you know, stole my career, they used to send people like me out to chronicle everything bad when it happened.
Right, of course. And it was, someone during the Delhi event actually made a very intriguing remark to me, which is that your art reminded her of court drawings. That is, illustrations that people make of witnesses giving testimony in court, because photographers are typically barred from those kinds of hearings. What I think she was getting at was that it had somehow the spirit of making things visible that aren't otherwise visible, which is what art should do.
And definitely it's one of my goals. My horror with art is always the idea that I'm just essentially repeating what someone else did, or that I'm using in my medium my tools to do an inferior version of what a photographer could do. I always seek to do what can't be done by other mediums, whether it's going to a highly, highly censored environment like Guantanamo Bay and using my pen to draw around the censorship, or whether it's other projects. I always want to do something that's intrinsic to my own medium. And I think that we were going to speak about the project I did with Marwan Hisham, yeah?
Yeah, actually, this is the perfect time, because this is a project, this is something very recent that Molly did, which was published in Vanity Fair, which was to illustrate, along with text, photographs that were sent to her from Raqqa, which is the capital of the Islamic State in Syria, by... Am I allowed to be disclosing all of this? This is all on the record.
That he's a young journalist who was based there at the time.
Yeah. So this somehow connected both the most, in a sense, the most authentic or original visual art, which was hand, pen, paper, with something as elaborate and expansive and postmodern as the digital network that was sending her photographs from the heart of World War III, if you like.
Exactly. I mean, this is a place where if I went to, my head would be chopped off in a propaganda video, and at the time, if he left, he'd probably be shot by a border guard. So our bodies were confined in this way, and yet on the cloud, we could move information and we could move pictures, and in a sense, I could see through his eyes and draw there, even if physically being in either of our places would have been impossible, or something done only at the most grave risk. And in many ways, this collaboration is perhaps the one that I'm most proud of in my life. I think it is the ultimate fusing of pen, paper, the old, old mediums with the network's true power to defeat censorship.
So now that we've touched the subject of Syria, we have to bring this to the third hypothesis about World War III and what it's all about. And naturally, the world can't currently take its eyes off of the combination of imperialism and new religious fascism and incredible profusion of arms and armed conflict that are all coming together in the Middle East right now. And Molly, since long before this really kind of before the match was put to this region by the Iraq War, I would say, Molly, you've been traveling. You've had a relationship with the Arabic-speaking world for much longer. One of your first travels abroad was to Morocco. One of your most recent ones was to Dubai, and you've traveled to many Arabic states, Arabic-speaking states in between. So you've had this very long-standing relationship with the Arab world. Does that come from, I'm trying to figure out which one came first. Does that come from your journalistic instinct and your need and your attraction to where a particular kind of action is happening? Or was it something more inherent to that part of the world, to the language, to the culture?
It started when I was 17, even before, it was before 9/11. And it was kind of by chance that I went to Morocco the first time. There was this like really cool girl that I really had a thing for in Spain. And she said that she was going to go. And I was like, I will follow you anywhere. And then she kind of ditched me at the ferry station. And she said to me, she said one of those vague things that seems really, you know, deep at the time. She says, fear is a doorway. Walk through it. And I was, you know, I'm 17, and I was like, oh, I'll impress you.
Yeah, and you did.
Yeah, I did. I went to Morocco, and I went there, and I was just sort of in love in that way that almost seems, I feel, you know, a little vapid to say it later, but like I loved the Arabic language. I loved the architecture. I loved this art that was both like so intellectually rigorous and so sensuous and clean, you know, this abstraction perfected in the work there. I loved these streets that were so entrepreneurial and so alive, that were, they like seemed chaotic to people who didn't understand, but they were actually just a city that was very attuned to the individual needs of the people who lived in it. I loved it. And so when I came back, very soon after I came back, you know, the towers came down and America descended into this hellish Islamophobia. It was a time when Sikh men were murdered because Americans confused them with Muslim men that they were trying to murder. It was, you know, a time of war and real just like bloodthirsty madness on large parts of the American population. And I started studying Arabic and taking night courses then, but I didn't really do anything with it professionally until in 2013 I was able to go to Guantanamo Bay. And after that I began reporting on places like, you know, Lebanon or migrant camps in Abu Dhabi, or recently I was able to go to Iraqi Kurdistan with Doctors Without Borders and report on these people who are about to make the illegal and very dangerous journey to Europe.
Amazing. But let me detain you for a second in Guantanamo Bay.
That was bad.
I had to. Because the Guantanamo Bay presented a very particular challenge for an artist, for anyone who's trying to visually record it. And that was just how much you were not allowed to depict. And in that sense as well, someone who draws rather than a photographer gave you a certain flexibility and a certain liberty that you wouldn't have otherwise had.
I mean, Guantanamo Bay is amongst the most censored places on earth. In the very narrow sense with photographers, to take a photo there is like playing a game of Twister. They'll say, oh, you're free to take photos, but you can't have anyone's head, so it has to be below here. And you can't have more than one door, so you know, over this way. And you can't have a camera, so have to kind of crop. And then before you know it, you're taking a picture of everyone's feet. And that's all your photojournalism can do. As an artist, I was able to draw around that and to draw the censorship in very, very explicit ways sometimes, including by when I was forbidden to draw people's faces, replacing them with these kind of blank-faced masks. However, Guantanamo, the censorship that they have of photography is a small symptom of what that place is. The entire purpose of Guantanamo is to erase. It's to take individual men and replace them with boogeymen in orange jumpsuits, to erase their families, to erase their pasts, the books they like to read, the soccer team they enjoy, their legitimate grievances and their humanity, and to replace that instead with these blank avatars that America could project all its fears on, and that America could say, look, look, we got the bad terrorists. Now, of course, we know at this point that almost everyone in Guantanamo is innocent. Of the nearly 800 men who have passed through there, they have obtained 7 convictions. However, for America, it doesn't matter, because America is a country that coddles its fear like its favorite child. It's a country that holds its fear like this, and it says, we're so afraid that these, you know, middle-aged innocent men that we imprisoned might do something. We have to keep them locked up forever. You know, cherishes its fear. And it's so much easier to be afraid when you don't know who you're talking about.
Which is why it produces, has a genius for producing multi-million dollar spectacles every summer in which it fantasizes about its own destruction, something most countries don't do. But So you got to explore Guantanamo and find that it's more than just prison pens. It's an ecosystem, including a commercial ecosystem, a place with a gift shop.
It has a gift shop. Guantanamo has always been, since about 1900, a naval base as well. And so about half of it's a naval base that has nothing to do with the prison, that feels very beleaguered that it gets such a bad name from the prison that's there, and really wonders why everyone doesn't want to focus on the nice stuff they do there. And then the other half is this gulag. But because it's America, and America is a very cheerful country, it's the whole way Guantanamo is run is with this sort of, like, both self-aggrieved and grinning obliviousness. And one of the ways that manifests is that there is a gift shop there that sells Guantanamo Bay Little Princess t-shirts for girls in pink, and that sells shot glasses that say, "It don't get mo better than this."
It don't get mo better than this. In case you needed that. So it's a really important site, I think, for understanding the present, the future, what we're generalizing as World War III. I think Guantanamo is, in a way that I didn't begin to really understand until a conversation that Molly had 2 weeks ago with an academic named Lale Khalili, an absolutely brilliant woman who studies modern forms of confinement in the context of what she calls liberal wars. So what are liberal wars? Liberal wars are wars, often imperialistic wars, conducted by the states of liberal democratic regimes. Now, when you have a war in a foreign country in which you occupy it, traditionally that war would be accompanied by a fair amount of slaughter and political extermination. That's no longer allowed in the sort of era of the Geneva Convention and human rights and liberal expectations. So when America has a developmental war, a war for the benefit of the country that it's invading, which is what all of these wars are, when it has a liberal war, what it replaces slaughter with is confinement and incarceration. And Lale Khalili has a brilliant book about this called
Time in the Shadows,
which traces the kind of origins and the lineage of these technologies of incarceration from colonialism, from places including India, including British Africa, and through world wars into the present day. There's actually a very clear lineage of where places like Guantanamo, Abu Ghraib, and CIA black sites actually come from. So a larger expression of this kind of liberal war, as Lale pointed out, is one in which it's not a specific institution, but it's a piece of land which is incarcerated. And the best example of that is Gaza, which is half of the Palestinian occupied territories, entirely under the sort of at the mercy of the violence of the Israeli state. So you also went to Gaza, and that must be the most vivid destruction that you've ever had to witness and draw.
I think it was. I mean, I was in Azaz, a place in Syria that had also been heavily bombed, and I saw very recent bomb sites, which is a different thing. But the thing that made the destruction of Shujaia in Gaza such a specific thing was that it wasn't just bombed. It was bombed, and then tanks came in, and they shot through the homes, and then they bulldozed, and then they uprooted, and it was this level of just devastation, like clearing. But then when you went there, people were living in the ruins of their abandoned homes. And in part, you know, that's pride, that people want to rebuild their homes. But in part, it's because Gaza, you're not allowed to leave, and it's so overcrowded. One of the most vivid things you notice there is the sense of suffocation. It's so small, right? It's 25 miles long and 7 miles wide. And there's a border with Egypt that Egypt keeps closed, and there's the border with Israel, and there's the sea that Israel patrols and shoots anyone who they think has gone too far into it. And inside, it's like this open-air prison. Everything that gets into Gaza is either through smuggling tunnels, which Egypt has been very deliberately bombing, burying people alive inside, or else it's through Israel. And there's the sense that Israel doesn't want to kill everyone there. They just want to make them really, really miserable. They want to keep them on, they don't want to starve people to death. They want to make them hungry. They want to diminish them and beat them down. It very much feels like taking what is a political problem, which is Palestinians being dispossessed of their land, and turning it into a humanitarian problem to replace political action and political solidarity with a sort of humanitarian triage.
And after an on a sort of regular cycle, to return with a liberal war to bomb much of Gaza back to the ground so that it remains a humanitarian problem,
exactly.
A humanitarian crisis rather than a political crisis that has to be negotiated.
Exactly. I mean, there's so much targeting of Gazan industry. One man I spoke to, he had a factory, it was a cement factory, I believe, and it was bombed during the war. He had no ties with anyone. It was just bombed. They bombed the ice cream factory in Gaza. They bomb sewage treatment facilities, bomb power. But there's this huge destruction of Palestinian wealth that happens like clockwork every two or three years. And obviously there's no business insurance. There's no, recouping your losses after this. If your factory that you built and you're a wealthy person even is bombed, you just lost everything.
And international wealth, since the international community is compelled to keep funding humanitarian relief and reconstruction in Gaza, which then gets flattened all over again. But I feel like we have covered some enough of the scenarios of how we are all going to die. We will either be marched into the rising seas by ruthless capitalists, or else bombed by drones or abducted by ISIS, all now on the record. Let's talk about what we should do about it, not in the large political sense, but as artists or as private citizens or as people in the world. When you go to what might be called horrible scenarios, where you have been quite a lot, or when you go to, and to just expand this to cover your whole artistic life, including in New York, including in the clubs, the Box and so on, but also more recently in places like Gaza, Guantanamo, and Iraq. How is it that you can go to places that are seen from the outside as being sites of despair and hopelessness and not return feeling despair and hopelessness, or only depicting despair and hopelessness? What do you do?
People sometimes ask me what my beat as a journalist is, because I cover a wide variety of stuff, from American prisons to Middle East. And I thought a lot about it. And I suppose what fascinates me, the through line of my work, are smart people who are perhaps being oppressed, but who are fighting. Perhaps that person is someone like a young construction worker that I worked with in Abu Dhabi, who, despite having barely graduated high school, had taught himself five languages and was giving information to The Guardian and The New York Times. And the only way he was able to get away with it is that Abu Dhabi was so institutionally racist that no one, including his bosses, would ever imagine that a young blue-collar South Asian man could ever get one up on them like that. Sometimes it's, it's like these prisoners I met. They were long-term solitary prisoners in Pennsylvania. One of them had been confined to a tiny, tiny room with no window for 14 years. He was originally in on the charges of possessing drugs that were levied against him when he was 15 years old. And these guys had completely educated themselves inside the confines of these little rooms. Andre Jacobs, the man I was talking about, he got himself certified as a paralegal and sued the prison for violating his civil rights and won $180,000 against the state. Despite the fact that he never really even attended much high school in his life, he was that sort of fighter and that sort of brilliant man. those are the people that inspire me to do my work. Those are the people who I think need to be amplified. Because I don't believe in charity. I believe that charity is corrosive. I believe that charity puts the giver above the person who is given to. I believe in solidarity. Solidarity and respect are what will make people give away their unearned privileges, or will make other people feel the strength to take those privileges away. Charity just keeps everything in place. Charity is just Nick Kristoff going to a slum in India and saying that he has feelings.
And yeah, and we love him here, but
do you? Oh no.
but that's because we someone should ask the people in the slum. How does art and visiting these scenes? I want to take this away from the extreme situations like the U.S. prison system and the world carceral system. But for you, the people in your life who have often been your heroes, your very close friends, and with whom you've personally shared solidarity, a lot of them are women who are transgressing in various other ways. And that's the nature of your solidarity comes from that, and what powers your representations of them, how you draw them, has to do with that. That's what makes them such rich subjects for you as an artist, right? I think that before I turn this over to you guys, we should have you talk about those people in your life and that kind of solidarity.
One of the communities I really learned my activism from, and that I just learned so much from in general, was the sex worker community in America. And in the American sense, I think perhaps sex worker has a broader term, broader meaning than it does here. It doesn't simply refer to women who exchange sex for money. It also refers to nude models or strippers or dominatrixes. It's a larger category, perhaps. But these were women who society looks down on in so many ways. Either it looks down on them as dirty, awful sluts, the traditional way, or else, and I find this almost even worse, they view them simply as victims who are not to be trusted to speak, who are not to be trusted to know their minds, who can be safely projected upon and spoken for. And, you know, these are my girls. Like, these are my best friends, and they're it's a community I worked in myself, as a naked model. And we have voices. Everyone has a voice. We all come equipped with voices. No one is voiceless. And perhaps my experience being friends with and working in this world of, like, really tough, smart people who were constantly told that they were dumb victims was something that shaped the way that I viewed the other people who were told that they were dumb, or the other people who were told that they were victims.
So just a few of the people, of the places who appear along and pass, touch Molly's life in her memoir, Drawing Blood, which is about all of these people and places, but above all, it's about art, and it's about a life led by art, being led through the world by the need to create art. So if you have a creative bone in your body, and you are interested in motivating and inspiring yourself, I think I do. I can make this is a personal recommendation. Read this book; it's extraordinary. And that apart, if you seek to survive World War III, follow Molly Crabapple. She has the DL on that.
Well, my book is very, very heavy. You can use it as some sort of bludgeon to fight off the zombie banker hordes. Before we open it up for questions, I just want to first off thank Kalagoda Festival, obviously, for having me, but also just say that I've spent the last 3 weeks in India, and this has been one of the most inspiring, exciting trips of my life. I've met so many journalists, so many thinkers, so many artists, so many writers. The energy of this sort of intellectual scene, for lack of a better word, but also just of the streets of these cities. I feel so lucky, so very lucky, to be a guest here, to be invited to speak here, to be able to speak with people here. And, thank you for coming, and, thank you for having me.
You're very welcome on behalf of India. I promise you that...
Are you allowed to talk on behalf of India?
I just promise you on behalf of India that we are working on our own ways, our own unique ways to start World War III. So... anyone out there who has questions or ideas about the coming world war? Yeah.
Thank you.
Yellow shirt, I guess.
Good evening. How much does this question goes to Molly? How much does dismemberment of the status quo underline your artistic zeal, your fervor to reveal the corruption that is manifest in the state, and to reveal all its faults, and to try and undermine the state through your drawings, through your work, and get to the people those thoughts that they should have had in the first place of seeing the truth for what it is, not for what it is projected by the people who are in power? Is dismemberment of the status quo what you are aiming for in your art, or is it just a revelation of what it is there in the first place?
I think I just try to get it right. I try to get it down truthful, and I try to get it down right. However, I have a friend, Zeynep Tufekci. She's an intellectual that studies sort of networked protest movements. And she said that one of the things that was in common with many different sort of rebellious people, or even revolutionaries from many different societies, is this almost dumb and stubborn insistence that something is not fair and it not being tolerable. Because smarter people than me would definitely be like, oh, that's not fair, but I could work out a scam and, you know, make it better for myself to my loved ones. And they would, you know, look at life as something that was fundamentally unjust and, you know, deal with that. Whereas with me, I'm just like, no, but man, it's not fair. It's not fair. How could you? It's not fair, man. And I think that that's sort of that mule-like stubbornness I have is perhaps what underlines a lot of my desires to do certain types of work.
Sorry, thank you.
Are there any women in the audience who would like to ask questions?
Let's go boy-girl.
Can I ask a question?
Hi, good evening. I think you could say my question is a kind of knee-jerk reaction to what you've been talking about. But I'd like to know that when you have been portraying all these works, and when you say that, you know, the American state loves to nurture fear, were you then feared? I mean, what was the response to your work? Were you tried to be muzzled? And when you talk about, you know, your works that are based on what ISIS was doing in Syria, I mean, was there a fatwa issued against you? Have there been threats? How have you dealt with it?
I think every woman in public gets death threats. Even if you write about something as seemingly benign as video games, there are people who want to kill you for that. I mean, I've gotten death threats. I don't think they're very serious. I think that's just people, you know, being online, existing in this era. I haven't really received any sort of state backlash. I once had a former Guantanamo guard come to one of my discussions and scream in my face. But, you know, I think that punishment for a lot of stuff in America, it's a career thing, right? It's self-censorship because people want to advance their careers, as opposed to, you know, the state being like, you cannot say that. And no, I have not faced that sort of thing from the American government, though I've definitely had people very, very angry at me and threatened to kill me because of what I said. But that's just being alive now.
And on Twitter.
Molly, thank you for a fascinating description of the activities going on around the world. But this Charlie Hebdo's brutal assassination, did it shake your conscience? And what was your response to this as an artist? Number one question. Second question, you say that the Occupy Washington, Wall Street, suffers from a vacuum in leadership, right? So how can art fill that vacuum?
I'll answer the latter part first. Artists shouldn't be leading anything. We're utterly irresponsible people. I wouldn't trust any of us. We're all dodgy. Second of all, with Charlie Hebdo, so I mourn the death of Sharb and of Walensky and of all of the cartoonists that were murdered at Charlie Hebdo. I have, you know, spent time, you know, in the French comic scene. I know that someone like Cabu was not just an amazing Charlie Hebdo cartoonist, but he was, you know, he was a giant in the French art landscape, you know? It was horrifying to see artists murdered for their work, and it joins a long tradition of cartoonists being murdered by authoritarians around the world, from Naji Ali, the creator of the Palestinian cartoon Handala, who was gunned down on the street, to Ali Ferzat in Syria, who had his hands broken by thugs affiliated with the regime for daring to mock Assad. Authoritarian bastards of any stripe, whether it's the secular fascist stripe or the nationalist stripe or the religious fascist stripe, cannot stand being made fun of, and that's why Charlie Hebdo was targeted. In terms of, did I agree with everything Charlie Hebdo published? No. But there were not people who did work that you were supposed to agree with everything. I mean, Luz, who was one of the surviving cartoonists, who did the very, very famous cartoon afterwards of Muhammad holding the Je suis Charlie sign, he said that the goal of Charlie Hebdo had always been to destroy symbols, and now they had become one, and so he didn't really think that he could do work in it anymore. He also said that the greatest moment of the march that they had, the massive, you know, French march that they had after the cartoonists were murdered, were all of the various hypocritical bastard world leaders all you know, marched in solidarity, I guess, with their own power. He said the greatest moment of that march was when a pigeon took a shit on Francoise Hollande's head. So that's the sort of spirit I associate with Charlie Hebdo. Is there anyone else?
Hi. I was just wondering, how far is the American public in general, how far do they accept what they're talking about, and how open are they to it? Has everyone acknowledged the fact that America invaded three countries only because it's America? How okay are people with that? And also one more thing, you said you talk about abortions. Isn't that extremely problematic for you? Like, aren't you in danger many of the times?
So it's hard for me to speak about the American public in general because it's a large country with a lot of diversity in it, many, many different types of people. I would say that by and large, America now accepts, I would say that they accept the Iraq war was a mistake, but not a sin, would be how I would put it. They accept it's a mistake in terms of their national interests, but they don't accept the damage that they did to Iraq itself. I think that America is a country that suffers from a lot of amnesia and thinks that history begins at the beginning of each presidential cycle. And so because of that, it has a hard time with that sort of reflection. But again, it's hard for me to speak of all of America because it's a huge country and with so many very different types of people in it. In terms of abortion, you know, I didn't speak about my abortion for 10 years after it happened. And the reason I didn't speak about it wasn't because I thought abortion was wrong. I had always been raised in a very feminist household. It was because I had believed and internalized this propaganda that even if abortion was okay, it was something that, you know, was for women who had been raped or was for teenagers who didn't understand how contraception worked. That it certainly wasn't, you know, for responsible adult women like myself. It's propaganda. One out of every three, I believe, American women will have an abortion in her life, but very few people would talk about it, and certainly no woman who is in a public position where it could hurt her career would talk about it, or almost none of them. And I felt like if when I was having the pretty miserable experience I had with mine, if someone I admired had had one and I had been able to not blame myself so much, not be so harsh on myself, and which is in part why I got such bad medical care, if I had done that, then it might have saved me a lot of pain. And I thought that perhaps if I can write about this frankly, I can save other people a lot of pain too. And of everything I've ever written in my life, I have gotten the most gratitude for that article, and it's from women from all walks of life, from all ages. Some of them were women who are from Northern Ireland who have to get, you know, illegal abortions in England. Some of them were older women who had gotten illegal abortions in America when it was banned. Some of them were women about to get an abortion. I really believe that our stories can save each other and they can save ourselves, and that by muzzling us and by not allowing us to talk about it and by making us feel ashamed, people who hate women and people who want to shackle women to their reproductive function are winning, and so we have to tell our stories. And that's why I did it.
And you did write about it, not just frankly, but very beautifully. And it's very appropriate that you say that right afterwards in the waiting room, sitting next to someone else in the same position was one of the first times you recognized a moment of solidarity. And by writing the piece afterwards, I think you broadcast that solidarity to many, many more people. One last question, and then if we do have the time, I think we should end with Molly reading a couple of lines from the book itself. But you go.
Hi, I just wanted to ask you, does it bother you that the scale of effect art has against terror is so small? Like, does the indifference bother you?
I ask myself every day if it matters or not. I sometimes despair of the ability of art to change anything. And, you know, I don't know. I think at a certain point you draw because you have to, and you think, like, what else am I going to do? You know, this is just in my blood and I can't do anything else. And even if no one else cares and even if it makes no difference, it's what I do. And then maybe it makes a difference to a few other people. So yes, I always struggle with that. I always struggle with, can art change the world? I actually, perhaps I'll read that passage, the can art change the world passage, to end this.
Do it.
Do you want to ask a question? I don't want to interrupt now.
Oh no, please, please.
Okay. Now, I was wondering, so we were talking about Americans responding to violence and transgressions of this, political transgressions, and I remember the reaction to Vietnam War. Almost all artists came forward, and America lost the war in America. Vietnam War was lost in America rather than on the battlefield. And some of those reactions of the artists were very, very activists, and they brought about a change.
I hope that we have this power. So I was going to read something very long, but I think we're short on time, so I should read something short. Okay. This is the conclusion of my book, but it doesn't give anything away, so no spoilers. In his 9.5 theses on art and class, the critic Ben Davis calls Picasso's massive painting Guernica an indubitably heroic example of political art. The painting portrays the deaths of civilians under aerial bombardment during the Spanish Civil War. But what Davis finds heroic is not the painting's content, it's its effects. In 1937, the price to see the painting exhibited was a pair of boots to be sent to the Spanish front. The gallery collected 15,000 pairs. Radicals often suspect beauty of corruption. Uptight fuckers, though they sometimes are. They're right in one thing. Art alone cannot change the world. Pens can't take on swords, let alone predator drones. But as disappointment and violence spread, the antidote is a generosity that the best art can still inspire. Art is hope against cynicism, creation against entropy. To make art is an act of both love and defiance. Though I'm a cynic, I believe these things are all we have. Thank you. Thank you so much, Raghu.
Thank you, Molly, and thank you all very much for coming.